Joining us today is Kenneth C. Davis. He's a New York Times bestselling author of America's Hidden History and Don't Know Much About History, which gave way to a whole series of Don't Know Much About books. The website is don'tknowmuchabout.com. Kenneth, thank you so much for joining us today, and thank you for writing this book because the timing is perfect. The new book is Strongman, The Rise of Five Dictators and the Fall of Democracy. Who's this book aimed at?
Well, it's aimed at everyone, actually. I know that's an easy thing to say. A few years ago, after a whole lifetime, professional lifetime of writing for adults, I don't know much about history, by the way, it was published 30 years ago. It's wow. Hard for me to believe that. But I had always written for adults thinking that they had gone through school and hadn't learned the things they were supposed to learn. And it was meant as a refresher course. Over time, I found a lot of teachers were using my books in the classroom because they were much more accessible, approachable, interesting, entertaining for their students. And I started to go into classrooms about 10 years ago via Skype largely, and had this really extraordinary learning experience of speaking to young people across the country and around the world in some cases, and finding them engaged, interested, curious, articulate, completely opposite the typical media presentation of young people in this country. So I really decided that the way to make a difference, a real dent in this problem that we have with talking about history in this country, was to write directly to them. Now, that being said, while it's a book that is ostensibly aimed at young adults, I don't write or speak differently to young people than I do to adults. I try and speak to everyone in the same voice, the way I'm speaking to you now.
Sure.
Conversationally, accessibly, and honestly, and a focus on accuracy and facts. And my experience with writing these books that are aimed at a slightly younger audience is that most adults read them and they don't know the difference. They're very happy, in fact, that they're, one, a little shorter, mm-hmm. two, they're very illustrated, and three, the type is bigger.
Yes.
So this is, you know, these are stories that are meant for everyone. And ideally, in my view, this is something that becomes a kitchen table conversation that parents and adults, generations can read my books together and sit down and talk about what they mean and how they factor into their lives.
Right. Well, I asked the question because I noticed that, you know, the according to the publisher, it's aimed at school age, middle school and high school kids. But you don't talk down to anyone. I mean, it's eminently readable. And as you mentioned, there are photographs and there are charts and there are graphs and it's very accessible. So you're bringing a very heavy, tough subject to a very wide audience here. So this book, Strongman, The Rise of Five Dictators and the Fall of Democracy, outlines the rise of Mussolini, Hitler, Stalin, Mao Zedong, and Saddam Hussein. Why those five? Any reason in particular that you narrowed it down to them?
Certainly, let's take the first four first, because I think that those are kind of household names mm-hmm. for people in respect. We've all heard of Mussolini. We've all heard of Hitler and Stalin. Most of us have heard of Chairman Mao mm-hmm. Zedong. And certainly in our time, Saddam Hussein has been a character on the world stage and certainly a significant character in American history. But I chose these five because I think in one way they all truly typify the type that I'm writing about, the authoritarian, the strongman, the dictator. All of them use very, very similar techniques, first of all, to come into power and then to accumulate and concentrate their power. So they're, and certainly in the annals of 20th century history, there could have been a number of other ruthless dictators who I might have included. But I wanted to, first of all, address this kind of idea of household names about whom many people don't really know who they are what they did, how they came to power, and I think that their story is so instructive for our time. One other connection between Saddam and the earlier ones is that Saddam was actually known as the Stalin on the Tigris. He studied Stalin. He had his secret police sent to East Germany at one point to learn Stalinist techniques. So there are threads certainly that connect all of these men. And we have to understand how quickly not all of them came to power in democracies. Some certainly did. How quickly rights, freedoms, privileges, the things that we have come to take for granted as Americans can disappear. It does not die in darkness. Sometimes it dies in broad daylight while thousands cheer.
You know, perfect example. And it's perfect timing as well that you tell these stories, because many of us here in the United States are concerned about the direction Donald Trump is taking this country and who his idols, for lack of a better term, are. The world leaders that he tends to want to associate with are of the strongman variety. It's Vladimir Putin. It's Erdogan of Turkey. It's Duterte of the Philippines. It's seemingly the worst of the worst, while he basically blows off our allies. and it makes you wonder what his motivation is. And so you look at the rise of some. So just for a moment, if you would, give us the history of Adolf Hitler. He didn't rise to power by a military coup or anything. He ran for the presidency, I guess, and he was appointed chancellor. He came up through legitimate means, right?
That's absolutely correct. The opening chapter of the book presents Hitler already in power at this moment when the German parliament burns to the ground, essentially, and he uses that moment to take the power he's been given constitutionally and expand it exponentially overnight. So how does he come to power? Exactly as you said, Hitler and Mussolini were both creations of democratic constitutional republics. And it's important to understand that we see them very often in history in military garb. They adopted that as their image because these men tend to be very militaristic, but both men were put into power in democracies. Mussolini first, and that's why I tell his story first, and it's influential to Hitler. And then Hitler, of course, later on. Hitler was the leader of the Nazi Party, a party within a large number of parties in Germany at the time. There's chaos in the government because nobody can put together a cohesive government. Germany is having extreme economic problems because of conditions in the country after World War I, a very significant event in all of these stories, by the way. And he runs for president, finishes second to Paul Hindenburg, a World War I hero in Germany. Mm-hmm. And as the country is in complete chaos, they turn to Hitler thinking that they will be able to control this rather useful idiot. And that's a very dangerous estimation that people have made. So Hitler is made, even though he's not elected himself, he is made the prime minister or chancellor of Germany. He moves very quickly, as I mentioned, with the burning of the Reichstag to secure those powers. He quickly overturns many constitutional protections, bans other political parties, bans the free press, starts to arrest and jail his opponents. And even as I say that to you right now, to focus on this moment in our history, just today, again, we have the president calling for the investigation, the jailing of his predecessor and his political opponent. This is strongman techniques. Now, I want to be very clear that I do not mention the current president at all in this book.
Right?
It's a book of history. But I do think that the lessons and the strong man's playbook that I outline are very important for us to realize, understand, and accept. And yes, this president seems to be excessively fond of these men, because what do they all really want? They don't have an ideology necessarily, some more so than others. They want power.
Yep.
The point of power is power. The point of torture is torture, as George Orwell wrote. The point of a dictatorship is being dictator. And I think that it's that that quest for unlimited personal power that ties all of these men together and makes them such a person appealing to a man like the president.
Our guest is Kenneth C. Davis. His brand new book, just out this week, is called Strongman, The Rise of Five Dictators and the Fall of Democracy. And you just mentioned the Strongman's playbook, and it's in the final chapter, which you call Never Again, question mark. And it reminded me of something else that I've dealt with a lot over the last, especially 3.5 years, 4 years, which is there are a number of essays that have been written about fascism and the signs of fascism. And this reminds me an awful lot of that. What, you know, there seems to be some confusion. I want to get into this playbook in a second, but I want to ask you as a historian about fascism. We have a controversy, which is astounding to me right now in this nation, where there's a very loose ideology, it's not an organization, called Antifa. It's basically people who are dedicated to fighting fascism. I'm Antifa, I'm anti-fascist. Yet we have a president who's saying Antifa is fascism, Antifa are terrorists, while he defends the actions of white supremacy groups who go around committing acts of fascism. I call it opposite world. What is your take on this disconnect?
Yes, and of course, Orwell laid this all out for us in 1984 with Newspeak and turning reality on its head and making words the opposite of what they mean. And 2 + 2 = 5. My father, my late father, was Antifa. It was called joining the U.S. Army after Pearl Harbor.
Absolutely.
And he went to North Africa and Italy and was in the, you know, the anti-fascist army that was created in the aftermath of Pearl Harbor. So it's astonishing to me that we are even having a debate about this in some respects, because I grew up believing that, you know, that was what we were taught as children. And I certainly grew up in the generation where we had to duck and cover under the under the desks, because the other great bugaboo of the time after World War II was communism. So we had these two great isms that were really bad things. And that's the background out of which I write my books and understand history and try and bring the past to the present. Let me just briefly talk about fascism, because it is unfortunately a word that gets thrown around a lot.
Yes.
And we have in this book, Strongman, the man who really uses it as a label for what he's doing, Mussolini. He creates a political party in the aftermath of World War I. Again, very significant event in all of these histories. And he calls it the fascist party. I won't go into the Italian version. I'm trying to learn Italian, but I won't trouble you with that right now.
Okay.
What is the fascis that Mussolini is referring to? It was a symbol of power in the Roman Republic, and Mussolini, like many of these leaders, was reaching back for symbols of a great past. He was saying, our country was once great. We had a great civilization. We are going to restore that great civilization. So he chooses this symbol, which is essentially a bundle of rods bound together with an axe head in the center. It was a symbol of power and authority that a man actually carried around in the Roman Republic and later on under Caesar. So it had real resonance in Italy. It meant something. And it's no accident, if you go to Milan, there's a train station there, the central station in Milan, built by Mussolini. And there on the exterior, on the facade, is the fasces.
Wow.
Along with symbols of ancient Rome, horses and giant, powerful figures. He was trying to recall this almost mythical past of a Roman glory. He uses this symbol of the fasces. By the way, it's not unknown in America, as I point out in the book. You can see the fasces in the Congress. It's in the House of Representatives on the wall. When you see Nancy Pelosi standing there, there are fasces behind her.
Wow.
There are fasces on the seat that Abraham Lincoln sits on in the Lincoln Memorial. There's a fasces under George Washington at Federal Hall. This was seen as a 19th century symbol of leadership, authority, order, and rule. Then converted by Mussolini into a very different meaning of fascism. So when people say to me, well, what is fascism? Fascism was not an ideology in the same sense that other socialism, communism, democratic capitalism. They are ideologies that we can think about and explain. Fascism existed, as I was saying before, for the point of power. Mussolini's only interest was really power. Did he do things to change his country? Absolutely. Did he have a program to change his country? Absolutely. But it was a program that was essentially designed to coalesce and create more power for him and his party. That was the essence of his fascism.
Right, and in reading what you lay out as the strongman's playbook, it seems to echo these characteristics of fascism. So you talk about the blueprint that go into the making of a dictatorship. Extreme nationalism that calls for restoring a country's past glory or greatness, placing blame on a single group, usually an ethnic or religious minority or foreign threat, warning of an emergency, often non-existent, or responding to severe economic distress that threatens the nation, calls for law and order and eliminating corruption. All of these are hallmarks of Donald Trump's presidency.
Yes, and I don't want to call him a fascist, and I don't want to call him Mussolini or Hitler, but
right.
These are exactly the things that these men do. So that's why it is the playbook, and it's been a very effective playbook throughout history to extraordinary ruthlessness and murderousness, of course. These men all took their countries down a deadly and dangerous path, usually, again, in pursuit of their personal aggrandizement of power, mm-hmm. their own egos. They all elevate themselves into a cult of personality. That's kind of those four things you just singled out are the things that kind of bring them to power.
Right.
And then they have a playbook that concentrates that power.
And you want to talk about what's in there? Because these are, I mean, I recognize them immediately.
Well, attacking the courts.
Yep.
We mentioned attacking a minority group or a mm-hmm. foreign group or an outside group or a religious group. So, you know, has this president done these things? Absolutely. I just want to be careful, and I'm not saying this makes him
right.
a fascist.
No, you're this not, but I am. Actually, I am. And I've been saying this and putting up the warning flags forever. And I mean, you can't help but read, you know, once in a position of power, the strong man does some or all of the following. And you talk about moving to control the courts, legislature and elections. Hello, legislature and elections. Heightens an emergency that may not exist. Creates a crisis that may demand military intervention, takes control of the media, increases the use of propaganda, jails or threatens opponents, including journalists, attacks artists, intellectuals, and other free thinkers, sets out to control the education system, attempts to create a young generation of devoted followers, doles out economic favors to supporters and allies, oh boy, creates a larger-than-life cult of personality, either threatens or restricts religious freedoms or bends religion to the regime's agenda. I could make a case for every one of those.
I think yes, in many cases, and that's what these men were able to do in all of the five cases I present here. There was insufficient pushback or no pushback, or the pushback was crushed. Mm-hmm. So far, you know, the pushback hasn't been complete. Look, America has never fallen prey to a strong man. We have this this term that we use, American exceptionalism. To me, what is exceptional about America is that in our greatest crises, we didn't have a strong man. In the American Civil War, we got Abraham Lincoln.
Right.
In the Great Depression and the lead up to World War II, we got Franklin D. Roosevelt. Now, both of them are men who made mistakes, had flaws. They were not perfect, but they were the opposite of strongman. And they eventually moved to expand freedoms and rights and privileges and democracy, both at home and around the world, not restricted. So that's what makes America exceptional in my mind to a degree. This was a question at the heart of the conversations, the debates at the Constitutional Convention. And that's why I include a chapter explaining how democracy grew from ancient Athens through the Roman Republic and right up to the point of the Constitutional Convention. These men had two worries, and they were at far ends of the extreme. One is that democracy is dangerous. It's one step away from mob rule. We can't let all these people who, you know, dirty, unwashed, uneducated, illiterate people make decisions for the country. On the other hand, they were really afraid that giving power to a president, a chief executive, a commander in chief, giving him control over the army was also a very dangerous thing. So at every step along the way, they created this system of checks and balances. And for most of our history, those checks and balances have held. Right now, those checks and balances are probably under greater stress than they've ever been in our history, except for the Civil War, perhaps. And so that's why I think that this really is a cautionary tale for our time.
Most definitely. And I'm glad that you sort of wrap it up by saying that, look, you say Americans are fortunate to still enjoy the freedom of expression and protest. Yeah, we're teetering on that one. But as the five stories in this book prove, the guardrails built to protect those rights are removable. A free press can be silenced. Courts can be tilted in favor of one ideology. The powerful can buy access that the average cannot afford. Freedom to protest can be restrained. Laws can be revised or rewritten to take away rights. Once they're gone, such rights are difficult to resuscitate. And then you say that we're left with hard questions. And right now, Americans really need to be asking these questions. What should we be doing now? What should we be asking ourselves?
You know, Nicole, it really is the question of the book. And there are no easy answers. I'll say that first. I grew up fairly optimistic. You know, yes, there I knew I grew up in the 1960s. I saw racial unrest in my hometown around the country in 1967 and 68. I lived through that period, becoming aware politically, I suppose, when I was a teenager in 1968, seeing the Vietnam War, seeing the convention, the riots at the convention, seeing two of the most important leaders of my lifetime, Martin Luther King and Robert F. Kennedy, shot down within weeks of each other, and thinking that this is terrible, yet we did move on from there. We did move on. 4 years later, I could vote because they changed the Constitution to allow 18-year-olds to vote in 1972, which I did, and I voted every year since, and that's where I start. We have the power to affect things by our vote, but voting is only one part of it, not a small part, but only one part. We have a voice. And throughout American history, it's people who have a voice, but maybe don't have a voice, who have changed history, not from the top down, but the bottom up. Abolition, suffrage, the civil rights movement, the labor movement, most progressive changes in this country came from the bottom up, often coming from people who had no vote, but they had a voice, and they took to the streets, and they changed the country. The vast majority of changes to the Constitution as it relates to voting have been to open up democracy, not restrict it. African-American men getting the vote, women getting the vote 100 years ago, 18-year-olds like me opening up Washington, D.C. to have a voice in the election, which didn't happen until the 1960s.
Well, it's still not fully there, but yeah, point
taken. And still not fully there. The end of the poll taxes, mm-hmm. which are making a comeback. The election of the Senate by direct vote, not by state legislature. So every change to the Constitution has been to open up democracy, and I think that's an important point in this. But again, people who don't have a vote have a voice. The late, great John Lewis was 18 years old and black. For those two reasons, he couldn't vote, but he was still out there marching. And he said, in one of his, in the moving last piece he wrote in the New York Times that was published after his death, democracy is an act. Democracy is, you know, it's a verb. We have to take part in this. Mm. If we take it for granted, if we are complacent about it, it will disappear, and it does not disappear in darkness. I admire the Washington Post, but I think they're wrong. This history shows that it often dies in broad daylight, decapitated while thousands of people cheer. And that's an important part of the history that I'm trying to tell as well.
That's an amazing line. It often grows. Say that again. It's decapitated.
It's decapitated in broad daylight while thousands cheer. You know, look at those clips of the adoring faces at Nuremberg, or the faces underneath that balcony gazing up at Mussolini as he makes these ranting speeches. These men were able to capture the loyalty, the passion of their people, because they promised them that he would make their countries great again.
It's a frightening prospect. The book is enlightening, though. It's called Strongman, The Rise of Five Dictators and the Fall of Democracy by Kenneth C. Davis. It is newly out, and it's an easy read and really important information. And it asks the important questions that we should all be posing right now, because we're at a really a turning point in American history. We could easily go one way or the other. I guess it's all up to us. Kenneth Davis, thank you so much. It was a pleasure talking with you. The book is great. I appreciate your time.
It was a pleasure for me as well. If they want to learn more about the book, don'tknowmuch.com is the website. It is also available on audio. And I love to talk about this stuff, as you can tell. So anytime you'd like to have me back, feel free.
I will definitely take you up on that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nicole.